What's up, guys? My name's Brandon, and this past week was insane when it comes to iOS software, and I had a ton of fun over this past week. So on Wednesday, Apple released iOS and iPadOS 15.3, along with the new macOS, watchOS, and tvOS updates. And then on the very next day, on Thursday, Apple released the first beta of the next major iOS release, iOS 15.4, along with all the other macOS, watchOS, and tvOS updates. But in this video, as we do every single Saturday, we're going to be discussing some additional new features and changes found in iOS 15.4. I'm going to show you guys my first experience with the long-awaited universal control feature. We're going to talk about the performance, when to expect the next iOS release, and then finally, we're going to cover some of the latest Apple leaks and rumors that have come out over the past week. All right, so let's start off by talking about perhaps the biggest feature in iOS 15.4, and that is Mask ID. So if you go into our Face ID and Passcode section right here, you can see we have the option now to use Face ID with a mask. So we no longer have to use an Apple Watch while wearing a mask to unlock our phone via Face ID. So this is a big new feature. You could also add glasses here as well while wearing a mask. And this is an awesome feature. However, it only works on the iPhone 12 and newer. So the iPhone 12 and 13 series are the only ones who can take advantage of this new feature. I'm guessing it has to do with the chipset inside, and that has some sort of impact on the front-facing camera and sensor. That would also explain why the selfies got much better after the iPhone 12. So we don't know for sure that that's the reason, but that is my guess. But this feature is awesome. It works really, really well. It also works for Apple Pay and for third-party applications. So that was one of the limitations when using this feature, when you had to use an Apple Watch to unlock your phone while wearing a mask, but you can use Apple Pay and third-party apps with this feature also. Now, another very big feature is that third-party applications will now finally get to take advantage of 120 hertz. So this was included in the release notes, and you can see here that third-party apps will now be able to use 120 hertz to be able to take full advantage of these displays on the iPhone 13 Pros. We also get some very nice changes inside of the Shortcuts application, mainly in the Automations tab right here. So now in Automations, if you go to an automation, you can see we have a new toggle down here for Notify When Run. So now you can disable notifications when an automation runs, which is super handy. That was always one of the most annoying things and one of the reasons you had to do that workaround to disable shortcut notifications. But now you don't have to worry about that with automations because there is now a toggle for that. Also, if we go into an action inside of Shortcuts and we go to the scripting section right here, you will see that some of these glyph icons have been changed as well. So here's how it was in 15.3. You can see Open App is different. Get What's On Screen is different. Almost all of them have been changed. Maybe not all of them, but a lot of them have been changed here in iOS 15.4. We also have a nice new feature added to the iCloud keychain. So if you go to your settings here and then go down to passwords, and if you tap on one of the websites that has your password saved, you can see here under account options, we now have a new toggle here, a new feature for add notes. And now you can add notes about that passcode. Another very interesting feature coming in this update is a new trade-in tool. So this was found in the code by 9to5Mac, and you can see here, they say that the tool will use the camera to detect cosmetic details of another device, which probably includes things like scratches, dents, or broken glass. Once the scan is complete, the tool will send the cosmetic details to Apple. So basically, it seems like Apple is trying to streamline the whole trade-in process of trading in an iPhone. And basically, this feature is going to help Apple understand if the phone is in good condition or bad condition. So very interesting. I will have to try that out once we learn more about this. But right now, it's still in development. It's only found in the code. We also have some changes related to SharePlay. So now when you go into the music application, for example, and you tap on the three dots right there, you could see that it now says SharePlay. So before, that would just say share, but now it says share play. When you tap on that, you can see you get this splash screen right here that says keep FaceTime conversations going as you watch TV shows and movies, listen to music, or share your screen. So Apple is now making it so that you can share play from applications instead of having to go into FaceTime and make a call and then activate SharePlay after that. So much easier way to activate this. I really like this change. It's also in every other application that you could SharePlay in. Also in 15.4, we have live text integrated in the Notes and Reminders application. So now when you tap on the little camera icon down there at the bottom, we now have the option to scan text. So you can see 15.3 on the left, 15.4 on the right. Just the new option added there to that section. Also, you can see here we now have support for adaptive triggers on the PS5 DualSense controller. So if you play games with your controller, you'll be happy to see that's been added here with this update. And of course, we have over 30 new emoji in this update. You can see all of these ones right here, including things like a pregnant man. So you can see right here, you have a pregnant man emoji in multiple skin tones, and a lot of very interesting and different emoji were added here with this update. We even have a minor change to the AirPods screen when it pops up for the first time. You can see just some minor changes in the overall shape and look of this. And then speaking of the AirPods, you can also now update them from a Mac with macOS 12.3. So in the first beta, it was found that you can now update your AirPods from macOS and not just from your iPhone. And then like I mentioned in the intro, we also got universal control with iPadOS 15.4 and macOS 12.3. All right, you guys always love when I do these little vlogs, so I decided to do a vlog for this universal control little demo right here. So we're gonna go ahead and log in to our iMac. We go ahead and put my Touch ID in right there. I wish we had that on the iPad as well, but we have Face ID. We go ahead and unlock this right here. So you can see we have both set up side by side. iPadOS 15.4 beta 1, macOS Monterey 12.3 beta 1. If I take my mouse here and I just move it over, take a look at this. Of course, it doesn't work the first time I try it. So let me give this a second. Let's go ahead over. Sometimes it doesn't work right away. It's still in the first beta. So let me go ahead and troubleshoot this. So if you go into System Preferences and then go to Display on your Mac, you will see right here, sometimes you have to go to Add Display and then Link Keyboard. That will fix the issue sometimes. So now it should work. I notice that happens sometimes. So you can see now when I take my mouse and take it over to the iPad, it's acting as an external display, which is awesome. I can go ahead and open up Twitter if I want to. I can drag and drop files. I could do so much. It is so cool. It works so well. There's no latency whatsoever. Of course, I'll have a much more in-depth tutorial about this feature on my channel and a separate video. And of course, in the final What's New video for iOS 15.4. But so far, this is awesome. I love being able to drag files. Let me just show you guys real quick. So if I take a file right here, I'm gonna take this over and then drag and drop it in my files. And there we go. It's gonna be right in my files application right here. And that's just super cool. I love this feature. Now, as far as bugs go in this update, I really haven't had a ton of bugs. I mean, a lot of bugs were mentioned in the release notes, but honestly, I have not noticed any of those listed, at least not yet. But I have had a few other issues, like I had ESPN and Reddit specifically crash on me. So both of those applications crashed once, and that was kind of annoying. I haven't had an app crash since like iOS 15, I believe, the initial version. So that was kind of disappointing. Also, I had some issues with Face ID in third-party applications. So it just simply would not work in certain apps. Even in the App Store, when I went to download a new application, my Face ID would not work. And I think it had something to do with the Mask ID and the new changes to Face ID. It fixed itself when you disable and re-enabled Face ID. So that will be a temporary fix if you are facing that. But that is one thing. Those are really the two things I noticed so far, is apps crashing and issues with Face ID. But not too bad for a first beta, especially a first beta with a lot of changes. And then as far as the performance goes, performance feels pretty good. I have had some minor lag and a couple of apps crash on me, like I just mentioned, but really nothing terrible. Face ID is one thing I did also want to mention, because not only did it get the new mask feature, but it also feels actually much quicker than 15.3 to me. I don't know if this is placebo. You guys let me know in the comments down below if Face ID is not only more accurate, but just unlocks quicker now. Again, it could be placebo, but it feels faster than 15.3 to me. And then also, I would expect third-party applications to start feeling smoother on the iPhone 13 Pro series and anything else with a 120 hertz display, because after iOS 15.4, we are going to have the updated UI kit animations for developers to take full advantage of these 120 hertz its ProMotion display. So I cannot wait to see apps like Twitter and Instagram and every other application just get a lot smoother with that new frame rate adjustment. Now, as far as the battery life goes, battery life is all right. It's not bad. It's definitely a noticeable decrease in both on-screen and off-screen time compared to iOS 15.3, but I mean, that's expected for a first beta. I'm not too upset about it, especially because it's not my main device, but hopefully it does improve with time. I noticed about at least an hour less of battery life, which is pretty significant going from 15.3. All right, so now what's next for Apple? When can we expect to see the next iOS release? And the next release is going to be iOS 15.4 beta 2, and I would expect that late next week, most likely on February 2nd or 3rd. Now, if it doesn't come out on one of those days, it could come out early the following week, on the week of the 7th, maybe on the 7th or the 8th. But I would expect Apple to be on a one-week release cycle for iOS 15.4, only because I think there's going to be quite a few betas, at least 4 betas, and then we'll probably see a final release either at the end of February or sometime in early March. My guess at this point would probably be early March, and we could also see an Apple Spring event in early March as well, which could line up for the final release of 15.4. We'll have to wait and see on that. Now, as far as iOS 15.3 goes, this is the latest public release. If you are not beta testing, you're likely on iOS 15.3. And this was a relatively boring update, mainly a bug fix, stability, and security patch update. Of course, we have a major fix for the Safari bug that would leak out your browser history and your Google IDs. So that was a very important bug fix and the main reason you should have already updated to iOS 15.3 at this point. But the performance, the battery life, everything is excellent. The battery life is actually better than 15.2 and 15.2.1 to me. Performance is also slightly better just because we do have a lot of those bug fixes that I talked about in previous videos. But as far as any additional changes, I've not found anything else new here with this update. Again, it's just a very minor bug fix update. And most of you guys watching this video who are on 15.3 right now are probably just waiting for iOS 15.4 at this point. All right, so now let's move on to some of the latest Apple news. So last week, we talked about the upcoming Apple Spring event and what's coming at that event. We discussed a new iPad Air and a new iPhone SE that would be coming. But leaker Dylan DKT, who mysteriously disappeared from Twitter just recently, by the way, revealed that a redesigned Mac Mini is also coming. So this new Mac Mini is expected to come with an M1 Pro or M1 Max chip, and of course a full redesign as well. And here's what he said in the tweet. For the Apple Spring event, we will be receiving the Mac Mini with M1 Pro and M1 Max, the new 5G iPhone SE, and a new iPad Air. iMac Pro is still on track, currently for a release in the spring, yet I have heard that there are still concerns with regards to production. So notice how he also mentions a new iMac Pro, and that is the next thing I want to discuss, is the upcoming 27-inch iMac Pro, and the fact that it might include a special, more powerful version of the M1 Max chip. So in a separate tweet, he said, I have received confirmation that there will be an additional configuration for the upcoming iMac Pro beyond M1 Max. A 12-core CPU configuration was tied to a snippet of code referencing the iMac. The internal naming candidate is iMac Pro for a reason. It is targeted towards pros. So I cannot wait for that. That sounds amazing. And I would definitely be getting that if that comes true, and especially if it releases as early as the spring. But again, there are concerns about the production, so we may see a delay with the iMac Pro. We also got some very interesting news about the future of AirPods. So according to a patent application that was filed by Apple recently, they are playing around with the idea of verifying your identity by checking the shape of your ear canal. So Apple describes the current issue by stating, quote, conventional systems do not address whether the user wearing the headphones is authorized to interact with personal features of the device, such as receiving messages from the device. Accordingly, improved systems for user identification using headphones is desired. And Apple also has a possible solution for this issue, and it's using sonar. So they state, quote, for example, various characteristics of the user's ear provide an echo of the ultrasonic signal, which is unique to the user. variations in the surface of the user's ear canal may cause the ultrasonic signal to reflect off the surface and generate an echo having a signature that is associated with the user. So that sounds insane, and I definitely cannot wait to see when that comes, but I would not expect that within the next couple of years, but hopefully we see that within the next 5 years. And then finally, I wanted to also talk about Apple's Q1 2022 earnings, because they were super, super impressive as usual. So you can see here, I tweeted out about their revenue and their profit. So the revenue for this quarter was $123.95 billion versus $118.6 billion expected. Their EPS, their earnings per share, was 2.10 versus 189 expected, which is also a big beat. And then the profit also rose 20% to $34.6 billion, which is just insane. So Apple continues to kill it. So there you have it. That is the latest batch of Apple news from this past week, along with some additional info on the highly anticipated iOS 15.4. If you're not testing this on the beta, I know you cannot wait for the software to come out. Hopefully it does come in early March. Of course, stay tuned to the channel for any updates on that. So if you guys enjoyed this video, I would appreciate if you gave it a thumbs up. And of course, make sure to subscribe so you don't miss any future iOS 15.4 or macOS 12.3 videos. But anyways, guys, thanks again for watching, and I'll see you soon.